Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the December 14th Hadley Select Board meeting. So we're calling the meeting to order at 7 o'clock. And the first item we have on the agenda is the consent agenda. So just reading down through the list, we have minutes from November 16th, November 29th, and November 30th. We have two warrants, accounts payable 1724 and 1725. We have a request for a one-day liquor license for Wine and Canvas on December 17th. We have the renewal of licenses issued by the Select Board for 2017. We have a declaration of surplus for vehicles less than $500 in value from the DPW. We have the Council on Aging request a formal appointment of a building committee to manage the proposed senior center design and construction.
Did you guys want to talk to that?
Do you want to speak to that, or?
We could put a hold on that now, or? Okay.
Okay. Suggested members are Ed Golding, Jane Nevinsmith, Doug Ray, Dan Regish, Dave Story, Suzanne Travisano, Karen Walter Zusko, and Peg Wilson and Rory Woods. Okay. And then finally, change of manager for top of the campus, and that would be Paul McGregor.
So moved.
Okay, motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any discussion?
Just a little, I got a question about the committee itself. Is it basically consist of the same people that were on the initial committee?
The ad hoc committee is asking to be.
And you're just turning it over?
Just turning it over.
I guess my only problem with that, I would like to see a lot more construction people on there.
More than half of the people on there have been in.
And they have credentials for building buildings and everything?
Well, I didn't keep mine once I retired.
You know? So that would be my only concern, because we ran into a lot of problems when you put the bid out and no one knows how to. OPM's going to help us definitely, you know, for problematic areas. But when you have people with construction, they're there watching it and they can come up with these things right away before they start costing you a lot more money than they should be. And that's my only concern.
A professional OPM should be taking care of that for on behalf of the town of Hadley.
Okay. As they did for the library building thing.
But was not part of the initial
committee. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, okay, we have a motion made and seconded. Any, Jerry, I think there was something on licenses that you...
Yeah. The license additions that we're looking at this evening, some people we have not received payment on. And I would either like them stricken from the list, or if we could put a once we receive payment for the license that they're applying for, that we can approve them.
Okay. David, can we approve the licenses this evening, since it's the last meeting of the year, subject to?
Yes.
Okay, are you comfortable with that?
I am.
They won't get the licenses unless
there's
they
only actually. Three you're okay. Waiting for. What's the problem?
Yeah.
Have there ever been any problems with them before?
Well, we just don't have the money in hand, right?
Don't give them their license until they pay the bill.
So. And I don't anticipate it would be a problem with either of them, but. Okay, so motion made and seconded with a friendly amendment on the licensing. All in favor?
Aye.
Except for DPW surplus equipment.
And yes. You abstain?
Abstain from that.
Okay. All right, that's it for the consent agenda. We do allow typically for a public comment period. Is there anyone here this evening for public comment? Thank you. Okay, no, there's no public comment. Then we can go forward. Stacy, you're on for 7:15 appointment, but do you have an issue going a little early?
Yep.
Okay. I don't know if anybody's like waiting at home for 7:15 to arrive. So Stacy Mashensky is here for Helping Hearts for Hadley School's fifth annual road race.
Yes. Fifth annual, big fifth annual. So I'm here to find out if I can have the Select Board support again. The race is April 9th, same time, which is 10:30, same place, which is Hadley Elementary School. And probably the same amount of people. I've met with Chief Mason and Chief Spankmabel to go over all the logistics of the race and safety and make sure we're in compliance with everything. So that was a good meeting. And again, to ask if we can put up a sign on the fence, paint apples on the race route. And at Snow Bearing, there was a, I forget what club it was, maybe it was a craft fair, they had put on West Street across from your house, they had put two banners on Route 9. Trying to get more visibility for the race to advertise. So again, that's like Snow Bearing, if that would be possible to do that as well. Or if you guys had any better ideas of where to put a sign.
How much revenue did you generate last year that you gave to the school district?
We are at $100,000.
That's fantastic.
I'd like to make a motion that we support this venture.
Yeah. Okay. Motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion on the Helping Hands?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
And I've been approached by numerous people, but I haven't mentioned it. But if there's any businesses that may be interested, if it's at all possible for us to put a regular community sign up on the corner on the Russell School lawn on the other side of the fence to really dress it up and make it look good, something we should maybe consider.
And you say businesses from the standpoint of maybe funding
donations
that?
Yeah, put up a nice sign up there, and for all these things we've got going on, instead of them making a banner up and hanging it, maybe we can advertise for them a little bit.
Is
anybody interested in?
Do we need to run that through the
building
and planning committee? May have some suggestions regarding that.
Probably the planning board, probably the building inspector. I know I just opened up a whole can of worms here, but it's just something that a lot of people had asked me about. And I thought about it, and I thought it would be a pretty good thing to dress that corner up a little bit instead of having 10 banners hanging throughout the year.
Sounds like a separate issue, but...
Yeah.
But that would be under your purview, correct?
As long as it complied with the sign violating 64 square feet, that's 2 4x8 sheets of plywood. That's a pretty good size sign.
That's a pretty good size sign, yeah.
You know, so complying with that, it's no issue.
Okay. Historic overlay? Exterior lighted.
It doesn't matter what district it's in. It's on Route 9. That's the minimum. That's the maximum size sign. Mm-hmm. Just get the building permit from Tim.
Okay. All right. So maybe that's something
we can put it on another night discussion if we have to.
Okay. All right. So then motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So good luck. I'm
thank
sure
you.
Another
thank
successful.
You. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Stacy.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have the police appointments on for 7:20. Is everyone here?
Yep.
Okay.
Good.
Okay. Would you like to?
Everybody, welcome. Okay, sit up front.
Welcome. Chief Mason. Is there anybody? Feel free to come on in.
Yeah. Okay, so you may recognize the two folks that are seated in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
These two folks are going to be recommended tonight for promotion from our special police officer ranks to our full-time ranks. First up is Matt Goulding. Matt has been with us since 2014, and he started as a dispatcher, where he excelled in every portion of that job. He has assisted with numerous updating on both the police and fire side of things, and showed incredible initiative in doing his job, but he has always wanted to get into the law enforcement side of things. We gave him his chance and hired him as a special police officer in 2015. Since that time, Matt has worked both dispatch and as a special police officer, and has also held down another full-time job at the same time. Up until recently, he somehow figured out how to work his other job, but also put in nearly 40 hours a week here, sometimes even more. This has saved us quite a bit in our overtime costs. He navigated his way through our hiring committee and has passed our physical standards up to this point. He has several steps to go, but we are at a point where he has earned his chance to represent us as a full-time police officer and prove that he can get into and through the police academy. It is based upon these things that I would recommend him for promotion to full-time officer.
Would you like us to take these separately or collectively?
We can do it collectively if you like. Go on to the next one.
Sure.
The next is Janelle Seitz. You may recognize her from a fairly recent meeting that we had where I recommended her for appointment to special police officer. Since that time, she has not failed to impress. She has also excelled in working here, especially in her training, and also navigated the hiring process both in interview and physical abilities. But I think her most impressive attribute is her dedication to this department. As you all know, we don't just want people who want to be police officers, we want people who want to be police officers in Hadley. Officer Seitz actually quit her full-time job so that she could dedicate more time to her training here. She often works up to 40 hours a week. She comes in so often to train, I sometimes hear my field training officers complain that they want to be able to drive their own cruisers again. She has shown me in a very short period of time that she wants to work here, and I would like to give her that chance. Just as Matt, she still has a lot of hurdles to get over, but I am confident that she can do it. So based upon these things, I would also recommend her for promotion to full-time police officer. This will finally round out our ranks, and as soon as Janelle is off training, we will be able to get our full staffing on board, hopefully for the beginning of the year. But then, of course, as you all know, I've said it 100 times, unfortunately, in June, we lose everybody again to the academy for 6 months. But at least that first 6 month period will give us an idea of what we're looking at.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So does anybody have any questions for Officers Golding or Seitz?
I'd just like to make the recommendation based on the chief's recommendations that we accept Matt Goulding and Officer Janelle Seitz.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Welcome.
Thank you. Congratulations, Janelle.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. All right. Next, Mr. Morales, do you have any issue going a little early?
I could wait a little bit longer.
Okay, so this evening we have with us Tony Morales, who's the Director of Community Relations from the University of Massachusetts. And this is, you had offered, and we accepted your offer to have audience with us this evening and talk to us a little bit about some areas of mutual interest. So thanks for coming tonight.
Yeah, well thank you, Ms. Keegan, for having me. Thanks to the Select Board for allowing me here. Really, I think that my reason for coming in is Mr. Nixon and I meet on a regular basis. We have, I believe it's in our strategic partnership agreement that on twice a year that we would make ourselves available to come into the Select Board to both talk about pieces of mutual interest, but then also just to talk just in general if there are any issues of concern or things that are coming ahead. So I'm not coming here with much of an agenda tonight, although I know that there are a couple of questions that I think I'll be able to answer. Just kind of in the spirit of openness and discussion with the town of Hadley, who's a terrific partner of ours, we want to make ourselves available and really, again, enhance the town-gown relationship that we have.
So. All right, thank you. So one of the things that's been a kind of a perennial question on our minds had to do with the meals tax, and it came up a couple of times just this year. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we want to make sure that any revenues that are owed to the town of Hadley are indeed being collected on our behalf and remitted. Mm-hmm. So thank you. David, just this afternoon, was able to, so I'm assuming it was information that came from you?
Yes.
Okay. Provided details of the fact that Auxiliary Services is indeed collecting the meals tax and remitting it to the Department of Revenue.
That's correct.
then, of course, the question becomes, the next logical step is making sure the Department of Revenue is then remitting it back to us as it does the all the other restaurants and whatnot. But thank you for clarifying that, because that's been a question that's been lingering on our minds for a while.
Right. And we can only hope that our basketball team has a great year, because I think that attendance will certainly affect the revenue and the bottom line. So let's root for that. Same thing with our women's team and our hockey team.
Yeah.
Yes, but we're getting it. Right. So so you know, you'll see. I think the last 2 years or the last two fiscal years are what I've given. You know, one thing that we didn't give, but we can certainly provide, is, you know, I think a comparison would be 2014, because I think that was the first year the local options meals tax was enacted here in town, correct?
I think it's been earlier.
Earlier than that.
14 might be an interesting year to look at. There was no football that year.
Oh, that's right.
But there was basketball, and we, you know, had sellout crowds that year. The team went to the NCAAs. So, you know, just to give you a sense of what things might look like in different years and how the revenue comes in, that might be another piece that we can provide.
Mm-hmm. We're just concerned whether or not it's all getting rolled into one ball, and we need to make sure it's getting split appropriately.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then, you know, I think another thing that we've talked about too has to do with the collaboration with the town, and I know that you and our town administrator meet with some degree of regularity, but you also participate in there's a public safety group that meets as well.
Yeah, we haven't met this year together, but there is regular communication with Chief Mason and Chief Spagnuolo. Okay. Officer Hartwright is a part of our on-call group, which meets every Monday.
Okay, that's actually the group I'm thinking about. Yeah.
And so that public safety group includes our Dean of Students Office, University Relations, of which I'm a part, members of the Amherst Police, Amherst Fire Department, UMPD, and Hadley PD. So what we're getting on a weekly basis is a report of activities that are happening during the weekend. We're getting a sense of what trends are looking like, where there are public safety issues. Over the last couple of years, I'm happy to report at least what we're getting from the Hadley Police Department are pretty good reports about, you know, student behavior, and where there were problem properties, we're not seeing as much, but we are aware of when things are happening. So we're tracking this on a regular basis. Also, I think that line of communication with both chiefs being new over the last couple of years has been really strong. We've made it a point to reach out to each other on occasion, sharing information around, especially, you know, larger times. As we know, in March, those are, you know, large planning events. And so we are in constant contact around that time, around, you know, strategies and making sure that they're aligned with, that, you know, that everyone's aligned. So I think the collaboration has been good. I've always felt it's been really strong since I've come aboard to UMass. I think that the added benefit of having a history of working with Mr. Nixon and other people on the select board certainly helps, and you know, having an understanding of the town of Hadley. And so I think our relationship is very strong right now.
Does anybody have any questions or a comment?
Not really. I mean, through the last 4 years I've been here, and through negotiations with a few people, the Pioneer Valley Planning got involved a little bit more. The state of Massachusetts got involved a little bit more off campus with, like, District 2, with the traffic and the busing and that kind of thing. So it looks like everybody's talking to everybody, finally, after all of this. So.
Well, that's the goal. I mean, I think that, you know, part of, you know, coming here, and of course we're available anytime that there is a question, that there is a concern, or if it's just about sharing information about, you know, for example, you know, even coming back before the spring semester and talking about, you know, important touch points, which of course affect traffic and flow throughout town. While I think that I'm hoping, and I think we are, a benefit to the town of Hadley with the economic impact we have, of course we know that there are issues that have a lot to do with traffic. And you know, that might be a place where we, you know, David and I talk quite a bit about that, you know, on a regular basis. But it might be something that, you know, we could present to the select board. But it's that spirit of cooperation and discussion that we want to institute, this being my first time in front of the select board. But if, you know, we can do this with some frequency, I think that would be a good thing.
Yeah, periodically we've got other ideas for negotiations in the future. So.
Yeah. Well, I know that they'll come up.
Yeah.
Sure. And we're about halfway through our strategic partnership agreement, so I think this is something that we'll We'll revisit soon. You know, Ms. Keegan and Mr. Nixon were part of the meeting, the yearly meeting with the chancellor earlier in the semester, and issues around stormwater and you know, plenty of issues, but that were brought up. But you know, those are things, of course, we'll keep in mind as we go forward.
Mm-hmm. University services handle all concession events, even if it's not university affiliated events. Say if Circus Olay comes in.
Yeah, so at the auxiliary services would, yes, handle the concessions. Now, I couldn't tell you right now. I mean, we could find out what the average number of concession stands would be open, you know, for an event, for something like that size. I think that we'd probably be at, you know, fuller capacity than you know, for, you know, an electronic dance music concert, which might not have many concessions open.
How does the owners of, you know, you rent it out basically, right, for the events? It used to be Ogden. I don't know who it is. Spectrum now?
Oh, yeah. Global Spectrum, right. I think they've changed their name, but mm-hmm. Yeah, something along those lines.
And they're the people that control any outside events? The university doesn't get too involved in that?
No, there's involvement, you know, and there's collaboration that goes along with that. Global Spectrum handles the booking for the events, however. And because of their reach and their ability to get top name acts, you know, that's one of the reasons why they're there.
That was the reason why the Celtics played there, because they're the parent company. They own the Spectrum in Philadelphia.
I'd have to come back to you on that answer.
No, they do. Yeah, that's why they do it on a regular basis here at the Mullen Center, because it's part of them, really, which is good.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I think that was certainly a good crowd. That evening.
Tony, do we know what the football schedule is going to look like next year? Are you going to be back locally or?
Six games.
So there'll be six games locally.
So all of our home games will be played at the break. The schedule is published online, which I, you know, certainly will forward, but can be found online. And the only thing I think that's tentative about those dates is the game time. In some cases, there's some TBAs there. But that's a nice shot in the arm, especially for our local hotels. You know, again, it's all about winning. And we have to, you know, hopefully Coach Whipple have a really good team next year. But.
Is there any decision on making the stadium larger? Are they still thinking about that?
Nothing at this time.
No.
I think that probably is something that, you know, likely as we continue our D1 schedule and keep it at home. That's something that probably be considered in the future. I would say it's a safe bet, but that's not official.
Yeah, the biggest thing is getting it to a league, I guess, and then there's stipulations that come along with it, the size of the stadium and everything else.
Right. That's absolutely right. All decisions that get made over my head. But as they happen, as those decisions happen, I'd be happy to come back and report on how things are going.
Anything else for Mr. Maroulis this evening?
Best way to communicate with you would be through David.
David or directly. I don't think it's very hard to find me. I wouldn't even be upset about saying my phone number on TV. I'd probably refrain from doing it.
Yeah.
But most people in the Pioneer Valley seem to have it. So, it's fine. And but yes, directly is fine. Or if it's protocol through David, it's also good.
Excellent. All right. Well, I appreciate you coming up today.
Sure. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Okay. Thank you.
Good evening.
Sorry, planning board. You guys wanted to squeeze in here?
Sure. So technically, the primary reason we're here is to get the extension of the contract with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission through our first meeting in March. I think this will be.
Yeah, we extend it to the first Tuesday in April. So it could be the first Tuesday of April.
Okay, so there is no cost change to this. It is purely a logistics issue of getting documents reviewed, getting them bound and printed and bound, and distributed. So just as an overview, we will have been working on this for approximately 2 years by the time this contract expires. We started out with a townwide questionnaire in the summer of 2015. There was a group meeting that was at the senior center where we had people contributing their thoughts to the future of the town. Pioneer Valley Planning Commission has been conducting interviews with a number of stakeholders. I think they've talked to you. They've talked to some of the larger businesses along Route 9, some other community groups along Route 9. And everything is now being integrated into the update of the master plan. We go through this generally the first Tuesday of every month at our regular meeting. You have perhaps seen some of it on TV. I also copy you on all the minutes for those events. So we've been proceeding steadily through this. It's a lot to go through, and it takes a little while. Mm-hmm. That's about it.
Okay. So do you need anything from us this evening?
Other than, because of the way the contract is structured, you are the contracting authority.
Mm-hmm. The contract has your signature on it.
So we are asking you to sign the to approve the extension. Mm-hmm. We support that.
Okay.
It says April 4th here. Would you like the 1st of June so you can, I mean, is the April 4th a hard and fast date, or would you like us to be a little further out than that?
That's already a month
later than
you've already built in that slot.
Originally, Larry only wanted it to 2 months, and we says, no, let's make it into the fourth month.
Okay.
So there should be plenty of time to
get that done. No sense double dipping. I'd like to make a motion that we extend the contract with PC from December 31st, 2016 to April 4th, 2017, as per the request of the Hadley Planning Board.
Okay, do I have a second on that?
Yeah, I'll second that.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
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 So that's when we get the copy of it. What are we going to do with that document once it's been received? Will there be an open forum or anything to kind of discuss it, or you'll be taking care of that?
We'll work something out. I think previously with the original master plan, it was taken to town meeting for a vote. As it happens, under the statutory authority for a master plan, the master plan really belongs to the planning board. So the step of taking it to town meeting for a vote was unnecessary. But so we wouldn't necessarily take up time on an upcoming town meeting agenda. But we would probably have probably dedicate one of our meetings to rolling out the final product.
Also, see what Larry recommends as far as rolling it out to the town. I mean, when you put it on a town, it would be nice to put it on a town website where people can just read it when they at leisure. And, you know, it's not going to be a short document to print out. It's going to be, you know, another 100-plus page document or close to it.
Will it be a supplement to the first one, or will it be a completely separate document?
Completely separate, the way we understand it.
So one component of it will be a schedule of tasks to accomplish going forward. And some of those tasks will be for the planning board, but as with the original master plan, some of those tasks fall to other boards. And as it happened, it just didn't work out that the tasks, the other boards weren't being reminded of their responsibility for various tasks. So the tasks related to the planning board with the cooperation of the Long Range Plan Implementation Committee were tended to by and large, but some of the other tasks were not. So we may need to have another conversation, whether in this forum or with David going over the recommendations that come out of the master plan, so that we may have a better completion rate across the boards.
Yeah, I mean, it seems important enough that we should spend some focused time collectively listening to this.
Exactly, and you know, I just really want to commend you guys for what a good job you've done over the past years. I mean, a lot of these things I see that we've touched on, that you've touched on, and brought in front of the people at the town meeting to vote on and move a lot of these issues forward that are in this master plan over the years, you know.
If we had an all boards meeting, we could kind of identify whose responsibilities what would be in advance, and if we could kind of start to divvy it up so people would go into the meeting.
That may well be a very good forum to roll it out because it does fall across a number of jurisdictions.
Right. So timing on that, what do you think?
Well, we'll expect to have a finished product by the end of March. Mm-hmm. So going forward, you'll be in the height of town meeting season at that point.
Yeah.
So I would suggest maybe late spring or very early fall, maybe next September, to start laying out who's going to do what.
Yeah, well, if any of the outcomes involve warrant articles, it might be good to try to do it earlier so that if anything was needed for special town meeting, you might have the opportunity to get something done.
We're not anticipating that there will be anything that will come out of this that is a drop everything. This is more evolutionary than revolutionary.
It's exactly what it implies. It's a long-range plan. It's not a, we've got to do this because if we come up with something like that, it's like, you know, how do we get to this? How do we go along this far with this way?
Yeah.
And it's like the last one was 10 years ago, and under the mass statute, every 10 years about this thing has to be reviewed. So, you know, roughly 10 years from this year, or next year rather, be looking to do this, something like this again.
No, we've been threatening to have an all boards meeting for a while now. We've been talking about it, and this is actually a great impetus to make it happen. And then maybe open it up even a little,
you know,
a little bit wider.
And if you do have like an open forum somewhere else, like Hopkins or somewhere, and each board should be able to present some kind of little speech on what they're doing, where we're headed, where we're all headed, and what kind of thoughts we've got going as our own boards.
As the draft falls together, we've been looking at individual chapters, chapter 1, 3, 5, and 9.
Yeah.
As all of the chapters come together, we'll see that you get a complete copy of the draft before it goes into final form, so you can comment on it if you choose.
Yeah. All right, excellent.
Do you have some ideas on these other issues that we haven't really touched on, where you could combine some of them? Or?
There'll be a new list of recommendations. We went through the recommendations from the original master plan, ticked off the ones that have been accomplished, dropped some that no longer appeared to be necessary, combined, refocused a couple. So there will be a new document coming out, so it will be the new to-do list.
Okay, anything else for our planning board representatives today? If not, thank you for coming. Thank you for the ongoing good work. I'm sorry, Dr. Zagradnik, did you want to say something in support of Mr. Dwyer?
Not really, except that the focus of this particular long-range plan is still to maintain the rural atmosphere along with the good agricultural practices in town. So the focus is still to try to keep the community pretty much open space rural agriculture as much as we can.
Good. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we have our last appointment for the evening with the some representatives for the CPA committee.
Yep.
So we have Edmund Matusko, Andy Morse Friedman, and Randy Iser.
Right. Thank you for allowing us this time to speak with you folks. You already know everybody. Andy Morris Friedman is the vice chair. Randy Iser is the treasurer. A week ago, I was at Town Hall, and Mr. Nixon said that we'd like to schedule time at this meeting so that we could have a discussion. So that's why we're here. I have a little bit of, I got a update on the amount of money available. And this is through November 30th, if I read it correctly. And there is $1,214,521 available to spend on the CPA budget. Mm-hmm. Now that does not include a $600,000 set aside that the committee voted to keep in the CPA fund, so that if we get a huge expenditure of funds, we would have to take a two-thirds vote of the committee to access that $600,000. So we just figured we should have a little cushion. Mm-hmm.
So there's actually $1.8 million in the account.
$1.814521. Yeah, right.
Yep.
But last year we, as everybody knows, when somebody fills out a request for CPA, it goes to the CPA committee for either approval or approval to go on to town meeting. It's town meeting that has the final authority to grant the money. We don't.
It qualifies through you.
Yeah, it qualifies through us. Now, we do have the authority to say, nah, we're not going to do yours this year. We can put it aside. And we do also have the authority to say, you know, you wanted this much money, but how much are you guys going to put in? Because the thought of the CPA committee is, who knows how long this money's going to be there, so let's stretch it out, make it last as long as possible. Now, last year we got somewhere about 60%
matching
from the state. We don't know what the final number will be this year. 30%? Okay. At the last elections that we had a month ago, other towns voted to join the CPA at various amounts. So that means the amount of money available for the state to give to the municipalities is less. Unless there is some kind of influx from the state, but who knows if that's going to be. So that's where we stand now. We schedule meetings as needed. I have the schedule of when the warrant closes so that we can present it to the town meeting in warrant form. Mr. Nixon helps me with that a lot. And what other questions do you have?
If somebody was to want to present something to you, and this is just to walk the people that are watching at home through the format here,
sure.
It would probably be your recommendation that they come to town hall, get a form, and then attend your meeting and kind of ask you to help shepherd them through the system so that you can save the problems of ignorance is bliss. I mean, this is a kind of a difficult thing to shepherd through, whether they qualify, don't qualify, phone calls get made, what does qualify, how much is available, the matching funds, like you said, when this was originally talked to the town, everybody said, you know, the beauty to this is we can maybe look for state grants, we can use some of our own money, and maybe there'd be other monies available to it. So it's kind of a complicated process to get shepherded through to the point of where it hits town meeting floor. And I'm just asking if you think that the way people should do this is to come to town hall, get a form, kind of get a general overview, probably from David, regarding mm-hmm. how this is going to work, and then schedule and ask to be put on an agenda and have you kind of review, talk to them a little bit about what they're trying to do and how the best way would be to get it to town meeting.
Right. Initially, that's what happens. It's maybe not as in-depth as what you just described. The form is pretty basic. It's not that difficult. If it's a small amount of money, or if there aren't too many people asking for money, the committee can decide right then and there. If we have questions, we usually schedule the meetings far enough in advance so that if we want to do some research, if we want to talk with the applicant more, we can. We will schedule another meeting. This board it consists of 9 people who are totally, like other boards in town, are volunteers. So do we get every single little piece of paper? Probably not. We get the vast majority of them. Mr. Nixon's very good at making sure that everything gets put in its specific mailbox downstairs. And especially now during the winter when things are slower for me, I can come in and check it more often. And if there's any, I'm not opposed to if someone comes up and I see there's a request for someone, but it's not filled out right, I'll contact you and say, hey, you didn't fill out this line. What does it mean? And I'll help them along. You have any other comments?
I think, Jerry, what you're asking is basically the way it happens. Somebody recently, I think it was the Zaterka Park, they came to an initial meeting and they had a proposed preliminary plan, and we found various issues that we had a concern that may, you know, town bylaws may not allow for this, this, and this, and we suggested to them, look into this, go talk to the various entities that you need to, and once you're satisfied that what you're trying to do is doable, come back and see us again. So we will help people we will shepherd them through the process, as you put it, so that they don't have to feel like, I can't do this myself, so therefore I'm not going to do it. We're very much interested in helping the applicants get through the process.
Right. And it's not that easy a process. People have to qualify, and there's other things, and mandates need to be followed.
Right.
And so people shouldn't show up to the meeting before town meeting and think that this thing can just get done.
Correct.
Because there's
Correct.
Many, many questions that need to be addressed far enough in advance, and if the questions get asked, you'll help them get the answer.
So absolutely. Absolutely. It's, let's face it, you can't do anything in this building without it costing the taxpayer something. CPA comes out of taxpayers' funds. So we're just here to make sure that it's spent correctly. That's basically it.
So can I just ask, and I'll be honest too,
sure.
I mean, one of the things that we're looking at as we go through the budget process is, you know, we're always looking to see what fund balances are out there, and whether it's school choice or whether it's, you know, the George Edwards Fund or, and trying to figure out, okay, these are taxpayer dollars, so we want to make sure that the dollars are being put to good use. And I mean, it seems like a pretty healthy balance in CPA funds to be carrying. And I know, you know, just anecdotally, over the past handful of years, there have been some concern about the approval process or the obviously you guys have to follow the letter of the law. I mean, there's statutes around this stuff, so you can't just, you know, vote and because you feel good about something, turn the money over. I mean, I think we all understand that.
Right.
But it does seem that an awful lot of people who've come in with an ask have been declined for whatever reason. So I'm thinking about the school fields, and I know that that's a more complicated set of circumstances, but...
That was a complicated issue because the first time we heard about it was at the presentation, mm-hmm. when we got a presentation of, holy crow, that's a lot of money. What are you planning on doing?
Mm-hmm.
There was some mix-up because it is public money. Any improvements made, any refinements made to the playing fields at Hopkins have to be available to the average town person to use.
Right.
Obviously not during scheduled hours and stuff. You can't expect to have the schools open at 10 o'clock in the morning when the kids are on recess, for example. But that was, the previous chairman did some research and found out and said, whoa, wait a minute, you can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you allow the, you know, the rest of the townspeople to
right.
take advantage of it.
Yep.
So that was explained to the school committee, and they've made adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
As far as it's still, I don't know if we have ever said no to a request.
I don't think we have neither.
The
town hall one, that dates back to when Dan Didkevitz was on the board, because I remember you and he went in front of the, and this predates, this was when Joe was chairing.
But right. if it got rejected by us, it would have been because it was not an allowed use.
Correct.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the things that we are very stringent about is if it follows the letter of the law according to CPA, then we deem it appropriate to go to town meeting to get voted on.
Mm-hmm.
We would not say, well, and if we get to the point, as Edward said earlier, that we have $1.8 million and we get $3 million worth of requests, then obviously we're going to have to tell somebody no.
Sure.
But we haven't been in that situation as of yet.
Mm-hmm.
And if whatever comes before us, if it is an allowed use by the CPA, we have accepted their application and allowed it to go forward to town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Can I?
Yep.
Try to clarify
yep.
that.
Sorry.
I don't believe the CPA board has voted no on any proposal, but we have asked applicants to either refine, define, or focus their proposals and to come back.
Mm-hmm.
And some have come back and some have not.
Okay. Yeah, and I'm just thinking it's kind of a healthy balance here for, you know,
mm-hmm.
you have a job to do, clearly.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
again, it's taxpayer dollars, and maybe part of the issue is that people, maybe you're not getting enough asks for these funds.
We don't know what else we can do. We have, we follow the letter of the law. We post the agenda, and and to be quite honest with you, if there's anybody in town that doesn't know about CPA, I don't know where they've been for the last 14 years.
We feel that way about many things.
Yeah,
and it is unfortunate that there are a lot of projects that would that the town would want to fund, but the CPA requirements are very strict.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to follow the guidelines.
Right.
And I'm on a first, I don't know how to program my phone for speed dial, but I do, you know, Stuart Saginaw and I have many conversations concerning this.
He's your state contact?
Yes, he's a state contact in Boston.
One of the things that is necessary is for the money to be spent, the town needs to know exactly what it's being spent for.
Mm-hmm.
So there may be somebody that comes with this great idea, let's do the school fields, for instance.
Right.
But they have no idea mm-hmm. what they're going to do, how much money it's going to cost. So they can't just say, well, give us $500,000 and we'll go
and
spend
it. And we'll
figure
it out, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
No, that doesn't work.
They have to come to us and say, "This, we want $500,000 mm-hmm. and it's, you know, every penny is going to be accounted for as best mm-hmm. can be in a situation like that."
Mm-hmm.
Then it's appropriate to let the money be utilized for that.
No, they've actually gone back and they're reworking the request, correct? Yeah,
right.
So that's still alive. It's just
It's still alive, and they came up with a proposal of they wanted X amount of dollars to do the field, and with no plans or anything, mm-hmm. no engineering studies that we could see, and so we asked them, "Come on,
it's not a blank check."
No. And actually, the way it works is that if you apply for a CPA grant, for lack of a better term, for $20,000 for a project, and if it's approved, you submit an invoice to the treasurer and the chairman. We make sure that it meets the qualifications of the CPA Act, then we sign off on it, and it gets transferred to the town accountant. He cuts a check for that invoice. So if you figure your project was going to be $20,000, but it ends up being $17,000 for various reasons, you don't get to keep the extra $3,000.
Sure.
That has to be returned back to the fund.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, and so when we have to make sure that when an invoice gets filed, that's Randy's job and my job, is to make sure that it meets the qualifications of the grant,
mm-hmm.
and that's the way it's working.
Okay. Did you want to say something before you had your hand up?
Yeah. So we're going to be meeting with the department heads in a couple of weeks. Do you have a meeting schedule that I can communicate them?
Not yet. I was going to plan on after the holidays.
Okay.
And. I tentatively, if there's a calendar, I was looking at the 16th. I think that's a Monday, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
We've traditionally have them on Mondays because we've been doing it for 1,000 years, so we're going to keep that schedule.
Yeah.
So tentatively, it's the 16th at mm-hmm. Golden Court.
Okay.
And
Edwin, is your committee full?
Right now, yes.
Excellent.
Right now, yes, we have 9. I don't know about the appointments. We may, obviously, for the various members have to get reappointed on a rotating basis. I did have, So, Andy and I are up in 2017, and I hope everybody else is current. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming everybody is, as we're dealing with adults, and I don't need to babysit them.
We don't have a problem keeping the committee full. If somebody leaves, we get a new member very quickly thereafter. Mm-hmm. We haven't had an issue with that.
Because it's a great committee, and Edwin runs a tight ship.
The system seems to be working well. I know I was at the meeting when the school came in, and you suggested them to go to the design phase, and that was like $15,000, which they're in right now. Mm-hmm. When that's completed, they'll come back to you for the major grant, possibly.
Correct.
Now, that $500,000 that they're looking for, would that come out of the $1.2 million?
Yes.
That's where it's projected to come out of it?
Right. We have to look, because in the CPA has three major categories, and there's recreation, open space, and historical, and
housing.
Sorry. Yes, there's three categories. One has two subcategories under it. So we have to, by statute, we have to use up the money in the set-asides first, and the remainder will come out of the general fund. So, and what we've been asking for the last few years is you got to use your money by a certain date, because we have $292,000 of, for lack of a better term, they're like outstanding checks, mm-hmm. where people have applied for grants and not used the money. But we haven't gotten a release saying we don't need it anymore. So we still got to save it for them.
Right.
So, and then we're also asking, because this is taxpayers' money, that if you come forward for a grant, that you kind of put some of your own money up front also. Simply because if you got your own dollars in the game, you're going to spend it a lot more carefully. Mm-hmm. So far, that's been working. Friends of Lake Warner the CPA has granted them $100,000, and they've raised $150,000 plus. The Friends of Zaterka Park got a grant for $88,000, and they raised, they're in the process. I drove by the other day. They have a board with a temperature gauge on it that they're raising more money. So what we're asking, just to make sure the money stretches out as long as it can go, that the applicant contribute whatever money they can.
How much gets added to CPA annually?
There's about $300,000 of taxpayer money that comes in, and then under 30% match from the state. It's another 100 or something like that.
So just shy of 400,000?
Something like that.
Plus or minus, yes.
Depends on what the state gives us for a percentage every year.
Right.
Of the $1.2 million that you spoke of earlier, is that all unencumbered?
Right now,
or
yes.
Or is that some of the 288 that you say
no.
has been spoken for?
No, that is unencumbered
as of money in the set asides, which can only be used for that purpose.
I don't have those numbers in front of me.
So fine.
Yeah, the majority is in the general fund.
Excellent.
Okay. Yes, the vast majority is in the general fund.
But we're at 3%.
Correct.
Yes. Yes. Right.
And that helps us to get a bigger percentage from the state. Mm-hmm.
And we were first in.
Yeah.
Right. And actually, I was looking through the initial law from CPA, and it's a complicated formula, but because we are at the 3% rate, we get the highest amount of contribution from the state. Mm-hmm. And other communities that are in for a lower rate at 1% or 1.5%, they get money, and then that's it. They don't get any more. Then the next group will get additional money, and the final group will get additional money. Mm-hmm. But
Dave?
Well, since we're concerned about being frugal and with dollars and trying to stretch them as far as possible, can we revisit the issue of borrowing from the CPA in order to take the 1.8 and stretch those dollars over a larger project? I'm just thinking of the Russell School that is projected to cost $7 million, and probably all would qualify, or most of it would qualify for CPA funding. Would we be able to explore that conversation again?
The only
one of the reasons why I raise this because I know that we had an earlier conversation where CPA committee was concerned that borrowing was not the way to go. But in reviewing the bylaw, the Hadley bylaw for CPA, it mentions borrowing. So obviously the people who put it together in the first place contemplated borrowing as one's way of making those dollars go farther.
So I'm sorry, David, could you just, for me, for the viewers at home, can you explain what you mean by borrowing the CPA funds as opposed to asking for an outright grant?
Well, lots of towns do it. It's basically you're borrowing against yourself, your future appropriations. That 3% that we're just talking about that comes back in, that would be paying off the debt service.
I got you. Okay.
Right, and there are pitfalls. If for whatever reason the state says no more CPA, we're still on the hook to pay off that loan. Wherever it comes from.
Actually, I think it's only the town's contribution that you can borrow against.
Yep.
Right, and the other thing is who monitors...
The state match, yeah.
Who monitors and how does the monitoring take place, whether certain things for a specific project are CPA compatible, for lack of better terms. Mm-hmm. Those are questions. To be honest with you, I don't know.
We can
be perfectly honest.
The conversation can happen.
Absolutely.
Yes.
The outcome will to be determined.
Right. Whatever's in the best interest of the Hadley taxpayers.
Right.
So that's what we're going to.
In a historical district, but the information you brought back, it doesn't qualify because it's all new construction.
Correct.
But I appreciate you taking the time to get us those
answers. Thank you. That's my job.
That's the kind of thing the committee is happy to do for people, to see if the proposal qualifies, to try to make changes in it so it can qualify. I have a question for the select board. Mm-hmm. Why do you think people aren't approaching us more for this money? We, you know, everybody no one is.
I think in part ignorance, and when I say ignorance meaning people not being certain of, and that was quite honestly part of the motivation to ask you to come tonight, was to talk openly about how this all works and everything, and so that David can get information back to departments. I mean, I think that some people aren't quite sure. So what happens is that the World Court of Public Opinion takes over as to what's eligible and what's not, instead of people actually going to the experts on this. And then I think that sometimes the process, people hear stories about forms that need to be completed and all of this, and it seems maybe daunting. Other concerns about, oh, well, you can only go to the CPA for small amounts of money. They never give out grants greater than X.
No.
I mean, I've heard lots of things about the CPA.
Did a number of years ago, we were presented with a proposal for the Goulet property for a matching grant from the APR. And we voted along with that one and other ones at over almost $400,000, and every committee member had 20 minutes to review the form. And after that one, we said, wait a minute, hold it, we got to do this different. We can't do it that way. Some of this stuff, if it's a small grant and it seems pretty cut and dry, we can act on it immediately. If it's a huge amount of money, huge amount of your money, we want to make sure that we study it and make sure everything is right, so there aren't any problems down the road. Mm-hmm. So that's why we instituted, you got to spend the money by a certain date, and then if we have to schedule another meeting to approve it or to study the proposal, we will.
Mm-hmm. And I think you see on some other towns what they've done with their CPA money, and it just doesn't fit here at Hadley of what they've done with their CPA money. And I think people are saying, well, if we don't do that in Hadley, I think they think they're not going to ask for stuff that probably they could ask for.
They could ask for.
Yeah. I'll tell you the exact answer to this problem is it's such a monumental task to get something done. We're seeing it from building committees now for libraries and for senior centers and for fire stations, how much time, effort, and work it gets to put into a larger project. And then once it gets done, making sure that that project gets a follow-through. The library's done a great job in taking a lot of the money and allocating the money that you guys have brought forward and utilize it for projects. But it is a monumental task to start from A and get to Z, where the last part of that gets done.
It is.
The representation on the committee, as you guys know, I don't know if everybody else knows, but conservation and historical are both represented on the committee. And for the longest time, I think a lot of people thought those were two of the major organizations benefactors in the towns. And right. I think that they see how much work it takes to get these things done.
Right.
Well, I understand what you're saying, that coming to the CPA is relatively easy and straightforward. It's beyond that is the difficulty. So I think people need to know that coming to us, we're more than willing to work with anybody, as Edwin said, or Andy. We want to make sure that the project is suitable. It has to be suitable. And if it's not, as Andy said, we will try to get you in a direction where it can qualify. Mm-hmm. We're not there to look at you and say, we don't like what you look like, get out.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we realize it's everybody's money in the town, mm-hmm. and everybody is entitled equally to it. So our job is to just make sure it qualifies, and we will help anybody in any way to get there.
I think the problem that we're going to run into on these bigger projects, and I'm sure everybody foresees it coming, if it's something like Russell School, or if it's something like the Senior Center, that we do end up rehabbing that building, which we were looking at originally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we were to take the CPA funds, it would drain everything that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody would be able to do anything from there on. You know?
Right, that's why we wanted to keep that some of money as a cushion.
Yeah.
In case something happens. A lot of times something comes up, APRs for example, where the applicants has been working for years with the state, and all of a sudden, for one reason or another, they got to act right away. And if the money's not there, so we wanted to make sure that there's a little bit of a cushion left. Mm-hmm. And so we kind of don't want to use that money if we don't have to.
Yeah.
And we can only protect it to a point.
Sure.
It's not like it's our piggy bank that we can't, you know, you can't touch. Mm-hmm. If somebody came tomorrow with a request for $1.8 million and it was acceptable and it qualified, mm-hmm. then we would have no choice in all reality but to say, take it to town meeting and let's see what the people mm-hmm. want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't want the money to go, but it's what it's there for.
I think most people think it's solely restricted to municipal buildings.
No,
and it isn't.
Well, it
it's
is
not. We
it's
spend money on the
Golden
church.
Court and
yeah.
church.
Yes,
steeple.
Golden
yeah.
Court and so, the church steeple, yes.
But then when you go to town meeting, they really look at it a lot tighter because it's going to a private entity.
Oh, yeah.
I think every single thing that hits town meeting floor has always passed.
Yes, yes. One hasn't.
Porter Phelps
didn't pass.
Correct.
Oh, right.
Correct.
Right.
So everything that has gone and it's the way to look at the CPA, for lack of a better term, is most of us have regular jobs and we have withholding taxes taken out of our paychecks. So then at the end of the year, you file your taxes and lo and behold, you get a refund. You go, whoa, free money, all right. And then you take that and you go out to dinner or you buy a refrigerator or something. That's the way to look at the CPA fund.
Door.
Or pay bills or whatever. But it's, you know, it's money that the town wouldn't necessarily, or money for projects that the town necessarily wouldn't have spent because they have more important things.
Next week you may have 50 applicants.
I was just thinking the exact same thing. Your overwhelmed, open concern now is probably going to generate the stimulus so that you'll be busy, folks.
We're here for you, folks.
Yeah. I think the reason why only one request has gone down at town meeting is because by the time it's gone through our committee, it's ready for town meeting. Yeah. It's ready to fly. Mm-hmm. And that's why it goes through. And people who are concerned about coming to the committee or going through the process, I can say almost everyone has survived it.
So you probably will. Has there ever been any consideration possibly reducing the 3% to a lower percentage to offset some of the burden on taxpayers in town?
The committee's discussed it. But, you know, if I can use a baseball analogy, being at 3% gets us automatically into the playoffs at the end of the season. So lowering the 3% is like saying, well, we don't want to be in the playoffs. You know,
we've heard rumors, we've heard stories, we've heard lots of things. And
actually,
I don't know what to tell you.
Dan Dukevich actually really wanted to lower it at the time, because that was at the time that the recession was really hitting people and taxes were being hard to pay and stuff, and he thought that would be a good thing for us to do. And then that discussion came about that, you know, we benefit from the 3% more than we would if we cut it to a 1.5%. Right. So
but I think there are people in town who don't like taxes. I think
back to the other side.
But this is tax money that you get an extra 60% for.
Right.
Yeah. So it's not like regular
money. Yeah, but back to this other issue. I mean, if they're going to go down to 30% right now, and you didn't have that money in there, you know, you're not looking at very much every year at that point.
No, without
I'll take a return on my investment of a third any day.
Yeah. Right. For every dollar that the town puts in, if the state gives us 30 cents,
you don't get it from the bank.
No.
You don't get it.
For a long time, we were getting, for every dollar that the town put in, we would get a dollar back from the state. But as more towns joined, that kitty got spread out much thinner.
When did it go from a dollar down to 60?
It's predicated on...
I'm going to say 6-7 years ago, something like that. I wouldn't know. I can find that out.
The money comes from deed transfer fees, and during the recession, there just weren't that many sales.
Money.
The kitty just went way down.
And as Edwin said, more and more towns are opting into it, so that reduces the amount of money that everybody
can get.
Right. Including Boston, so you know what that means.
So we appreciate you guys coming out
tonight.
Thank you. Really do. It helped clarify a lot of things, and it helps going into the budget planning season, too.
Yeah. Okay. When it's available. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
We work for you guys.
Yep. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, let's see, next on the agenda we have Hadley Hazard Mitigation Plan, David.
Yes, so we have developed an update to the Hadley Hazard Mitigation Plan, which is one component of our overall emergency preparedness and response plan. We need a certificate of adoption to be approved by the board before January 1st in order for this plan to be effective. This has been reviewed by our emergency management director, Chief Spanknebel, and he recommends that the board takes that vote.
Okay,
so moved.
I don't know what we're voting on. I just see that it's a whereas of a plan.
Adoption.
Is that not in place currently?
Adoption or resolution.
Is this currently in effect?
Yeah, this is an update, isn't it?
Yeah, it's an update. So we have a hazard mitigation plan for natural hazards such as floods, for windstorms, snow events, power outages caused by weather. This is just an update reflecting what we've done in order to address mitigation strategies to bring our risk down for all of these events that may or may not happen. We had a working team with the police department, fire department, senior center, myself, the assessors, and planning board member.
I think the point he's making is the certificate of adoption is here for us to vote on, but we don't really know what
There's no plan.
There's no plan, like a revised plan.
Right. So I had actually asked that be put into the agenda, so apparently it didn't happen.
Yeah. Is there something time sensitive for tonight, or can we?
It is time sensitive, and I recommend that you do it.
I'd like to see
I did ask for it to be put into the executive folder because it does have security issues.
Hang on.
It's not there either, though, is it?
Let's see.
It's actually the certificate of adoption.
No. I had never seen the plan.
So if I got a copy of that plan over to Jerry tomorrow morning, is that going to be good enough?
Well, when does it need to be authorized?
By January 1st.
Okay, so this is the meeting that has to be done. Has anybody else seen the plan?
Yes.
No.
Have you seen the plan?
No. So you have. So go through again. So it's you, both chiefs.
The senior director. Planning board, the assessors, conservation commission, myself.
How big is the document, David?
A couple hundred pages.
And since this is really just an update?
This is an update to something that you have already in place.
Right.
And it was the recommendation of the committee.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I will second Joyce's motion.
Okay. Is that something that you could, I mean, is there like an executive summary of the updates?
Yep, I can do that.
Could you circulate that? I mean, if we vote tonight, could you circulate that?
Sure.
Okay, there's a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay, free cash policy is next. And this is, we started this discussion. Actually, we had quite a bit of discussion at our last meeting, and then the Finance Committee met last night. And David, you're going to update us on that discussion?
So we did develop a free cash policy, which we debated last week's meeting. Finance Committee received a copy of it, and they met last night. They reviewed it. They like it. They recommend it. They would like to talk about this as well as the stabilization policy at your next meeting, which is January 4th. But there's no reason not to adopt the Finance Committee's recommendation of the free cash policy.
Okay. Does somebody want to make a motion to approve the free cash policy as presented?
Do we need to do that tonight, or can we do that when the Finance Committee is here on the floor?
I'd like to have the Finance Committee here if there's any more discussion between the boards.
That's fine. I mean, it doesn't really matter to me.
I'm inclined to agree with that, too. The last meeting we had with the tri-board, we hardly had anyone here.
Right, yeah. So,
and they're scheduled on the 4th, I think it would be better, to get an input from everybody that night. There's no rush on passing this anyways, right?
Did no, I? The only thing I just want to be careful of is we're going to have a pretty packed agenda on the 4th. So I think if there's any it shouldn't be any concern. I mean, we agreed in principle, and the Finance Committee last night also said that they wanted to approve the policy. So we can go ahead and vote. I just hope we can kind of minimize the discussion, because we're going to be talking about revenues and a lot of other things that night as well. Because if that once January hits, we're going slamming right into budget season. But the budget will have to be done in the context of this policy, assuming that we do vote it then.
I had some questions for the Finance Committee regarding this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And whether they thought it was, I understand that they looked at it and they liked it, but is it the only opportunity available to us? And do they necessarily feel that this is the best way to go as well?
Mm-hmm.
On the last
and meeting, I still don't want to put this in writing here, because we still don't know what federal and state's doing. The state's $40 billion in deficit right now, along with all their cuts. You know, it's going to trickle down to us. And we're going to have some major decisions to make here. I hate to tell you, no matter what you adopt here this evening.
Okay, but what I'm hearing is that people don't want to vote on this tonight and want to hold until the Finance Committee's present on the 4th.
I would, yes, please, ask for that.
I agree with Jerry. I think I would just like to hear their viewpoint.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It may differ from what we discussed the other day, and it may not. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah,
at least everybody be in the same room and listening to the same questions.
Okay. All right, so we'll put that on the agenda then, David, for the 4th. Okay, DCR public announcement of interest in acquiring land in Hadley.
John, could you figure out where this land was?
There should be a map there.
I'm guessing it's the purple piece that's on there.
Yeah, that's where you rented the garage, I think. Is this the bike track, the bike trail one?
No, this is off of Hockenham Road.
It's on 47.
Oh, okay.
I just can't tell.
Where are we at with the bike path one?
You guys made that announcement last week.
Yep. I asked for how much it was going to take off the tax rate. How much revenue we were getting for that.
All right, so this piece of property is down off of 47.
Yep, 5.3 acres.
North of Mitch's Marina, it looks like. Mm-hmm. A little bit. Shepherd's Island, I've never heard of that.
That's got to be the only island out there. I'm the same with you, Donald. I never knew the name of that island. Rainbow Beach, I mean, I knew Bob, but mm-hmm.
No. No, sure.
Shepherd's Island's the island right off of Mitch's Marina down there. That's where that is, correct? Is it adjacent to other pieces of property that have been already saved? And it's only a rhetorical question. It has nothing to do about my motion here. I motion that we accept this, but mm-hmm. I'm just trying to get a feel for where this is.
Yeah, we're just voting to.
I'll second.
Post.
Accept it.
Where's the actual road? Okay, there's the road. Okay.
Here's the road. Mm-hmm. So I think it looks like it's behind.
Yeah, so I believe all the land there in green is conservation land or DCR land.
Okay. So it's almost like Woja Wotas or something down
correct.
There, isn't it?
In the back there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's a street up here. Okay. Well, again, tonight what we're being asked to do is
post it.
So is there a motion?
Motion and second already.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there was a second?
Me.
No, sorry, I didn't hear you. Probably from that cold that you caught somewhere.
Yeah, sitting next to me.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, we already took care of. January 10th, special election warrant signing. So this is for the January 10th vote?
Yep.
So moved.
Second for discussion.
Okay. Discussion?
It's awful hard to understand why we can't have impacts to the tax rate on each and every one of those questions. I would think that it would help everybody if they understood what kind of money we're talking about, what it's for, and the impact on taxes.
David, do you want to articulate the opinion of council again on that?
Yeah, so unfortunately with the published warrant for that election, we can't deviate from the Department of Revenue language, so our hands are tied there. But as a public education and outreach measure, we have prepared on yellow sheets of paper an explanation of each of the items, what's it for, how much it's going to cost, what's the impact upon taxes, and that's going to be mailed out in the December tax bills.
And available at the voting? Is it going to be available at the polls as well?
I can't make it available within 150 feet, whatever that
informationally, you can't sponsor it, but you can informationally provide
it. Put that out there. Can't do anything that makes it look like we're trying to endorse or not endorse.
But it's just information.
It's just information, but that's why we're sending it out in the tax bills.
Can we post it at other places also?
Sure, we could put it on
the
HPAT, we can put it on
library.
The library, we can put it on
post
the post office, we can put it anywhere we want.
Mm-hmm. Well, it should be at the town hall too, yeah.
Town hall, yes.
So why don't we do that?
Oh yeah, we plan to do that.
Okay.
We've been folding thousands of these things.
And it will be on channel
HPAP 191.
Geez, I just said five. How antiquated am I? Mm-hmm.
And the website.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. David, compensation and classification report. Also known as the infamous wage and salary study. So you have some information for us this evening to
right.
take under
so
advisement?
You're seeing this for the first time, so obviously you'll want to take this under advisement. But I was able to finish this up. I was asked to look at the wages compared to other communities, and I was also asked to look at the potential COLAs, cost of living adjustments, for the upcoming year. So, in effect, Hadley fits in well with other towns of similar size and economic stature. The wages are not too high, they're not too low, they're right pretty much in the middle. The cost of living adjustments, you have the low end of Social Security COLA, which has been at or near zero for 2 years now, compared to the high range of about 2% for the CPI for the Northeast region, because the Northeast is a more expensive place to live. I also found a survey of towns that are contemplating, they haven't made this decision yet, but contemplating COLAs for the fiscal year 2018, and that information is in there. They range from 1% at the low end to 3% at the high end. So Hadley seems like it's right in the middle of the compensation schedules for other towns, and it looks like a range of 0 to 2% COLA for the future.
Okay, and we can utilize this information as we move through the budget process and we're looking at organization charts and the
yep.
like. Okay. All right, so we have that now, so everybody
study
it, enjoy it, and more to come on that. In Select Board meeting schedule for 2017, David, you've thrown out suggested dates.
Right, I'd like us to take a look at January. It looks like we're having one meeting in January where we're focusing in on board matters, and then January 18th we've proposed all committees meeting. It may be in our best interest to have another meeting in January.
Yeah, just looking at that, I'm just worried that the regular business, we won't, you know, the January 18th meeting, we're not going to get any regular business done.
Since I have to produce a budget on January 25th, I recommend January 25th.
What was the idea behind the all committees meeting, if you could refresh my memory, please?
If you recall, last year, the chair recommended that we get everybody in a room together at the same time. So we did that, and I think it worked out well. We were all over at Hopkins Academy, but because it was the first time we'd ever done anything like that, basically each department kind of stood up and said, you know, here's what's going on. You know, it was more like just mini presentations from everybody. Which I think was really helpful, but there really wasn't any dialogue back and forth. It didn't really allow for that. So I think the thought was, okay, now that we took the first step, maybe this year, we could have everybody in the room together at the same time. We'll be getting a better sense of where people are coming from with asks for the budget, any planned changes and the like. And this is an opportunity to make sure that the messaging is consistent across the town departments.
What if we didn't do that at a selectmen's meeting, which is a little touch intimidating, actually? What if we had a regular selectmen's meeting on the 18th and we did it the following Wednesday, not at a selectmen's meeting, but at a kind of an invitational meeting?
Well, I think that's the intent of this would be,
yeah,
it's
could.
A scheduled meeting for us because it's a
yeah.
forum,
which
but
one?
It would probably be at Hopkins.
What are you talking about?
The
18th. The
18th.
Of what?
January.
David?
Let's conduct regular business at the 18th, and the following week let's have an all-committees meeting.
Whatever the pleasure of the board is, it seems like you're farther down the road than you were this time last year. This time last year you had the SWOT analysis in place, and now you have a number of other things that are helpful for you to define the strategic vision of the town. So you've got the service delivery plan, you have the conversation with the form, change of form of government, you have goals and objectives that you've set for yourself, so it seems like more things can be pulled together.
So we're going to have three meetings in a row, 18th, 25th, and 1st?
That's the suggestion. David's proposing the 25th because that's when he's going to be...
That's the deadline that you set for me for the budget.
Budget roll-up. It's just to add another business meeting in January. Now, if that's your deadline and we aren't really going to be looking at that roll-up until February 1st for the first time, what do you think?
I'm thinking that I give you the budget books on the 25th, talk about the overall structure of it, and that you have time for other business on the 25th.
And then meet again on the 1st.
Yes.
And meet again on the 1st, because we can't get enough of this stuff.
Yes, sir.
Well, I mean, and if there isn't any business to discuss, it can be a very short meeting on the 25th.
I don't think that'll happen.
I don't either, but I'm just throwing it off. Just tossing or something.
Let's be positive this new coming year, right? Mm-hmm.
Could we possibly back up January 18th a little bit? Because we have 14 days from the 4th. Mm-hmm. And then we don't have back-to-back 18 and 25.
You also have an MMA conference somewhere in
right.
there,
too.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
That's that weekend.
Yeah. That's the 18th?
No, it's actually that Friday, Saturday.
Yeah,
so Thursday, Friday, Saturday after. Is it 19th, 20th, 21st?
The 19th and 20th, yeah.
Or Friday, Saturday,
20th and 21st.
Yeah.
There'll be an inauguration as well.
Okay. I don't know who for who, but anyway, we'll go for them.
I think he's talking about the national stage. Mm,
great.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm okay with this. I think the 18th, it gives the department heads after the holidays a chance to kind of collect their own thoughts. And
you know, to Jerry's point, I mean, I don't see why we can't have the one in between the 4th and the 18th if you want to take care of regular business.
And not do the 25th?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because then you're already at the 1st again, so...
I'm just worried about squeezing David. That's
yeah.
only...
Yeah.
He
yeah.
had the 25th. I didn't just want to squeeze David.
No, I understand
David.
That.
Especially with the holidays.
So what are you suggesting, Jerry?
I think the 25th, but I would say the 25th would be the all-committees meeting and use regular standard business on the 18th. Then you're on the 1st and the 3rd for regular business. For all your fans.
Have you,
I like to watch you on TV.
You too.
Have you got any responses back from the committees and see if this is a good date for them, first of all?
I don't know if we've even notified them yet.
Did you toss this
yeah,
out to
we,
the department
at the department head meeting, we gave them the date of the 18th and said that we didn't have a format for the all-committees meeting, but to put it on the radar. So they've been notified. Nobody's come to me and said that they can't do it.
See, I think of committees, I think of school committee, historical commission. That's who I think of there. I don't think of the clerk's office and the assessor's office. I don't understand what we're trying to do here. Is it the committees that we're talking to or town hall
employees? Department heads.
Department heads.
Well, I'm thinking it's both.
Yeah, and I think the format of this is something that the select board will put together. What would you find most useful? What
really
kind of communication
everybody.
Do you want to see
yeah.
between your committees and your volunteers and your professional staff? How does that advance the budget?
Well, we got to set it first, and hopefully they'll be a part of that before you roll it out. Right?
So do you want to move that to the 25th? I mean,
right.
it's easy enough
to,
for you to notify
be better
the date
David
change.
So that he can have some conversation with people between... Christmas or whatnot, and then you could roll it out to us on the 25th, right? Have our all-board meeting on the 18th?
Now I think he's gleaning information from that meeting to put together.
Yeah, last minute again.
No, not last minute, John. Mm-hmm. It's making an informed...
What's good for
David,
you?
What's better for you? Is
that's
exactly. Which one's
ask.
Better for you? Would you rather the all committees on the 18th or the 25th?
I think that based upon the comments that we got back on some of the budget processes in the past is that people don't feel that they're being heard by the time the budget is issued, and that I think that we should try to have an all boards and committees meeting prior to the final budget being out there. We may not be able to give everybody everything that they're looking for. That's usually the case.
Why do the committees care about the budgets?
Why do they
care? How much do they care about the budgets?
Well, it depends on the ask. It
depends which committee. Your school committee does. Your building committee's
got a lot riding on them.
Okay, all right.
Senior Center Committee.
Board of Health with Board the Health. Waste of the stormwater.
You know, the 11th is the day after the vote, too, so maybe we could have some discussion on that.
18th and the 25th, just figure out which one's best for the all committee and which one's best for the other one.
And we'll show up.
Yeah, and the all boards, all committees meeting is really for you. I mean, this is an opportunity to get your strategic vision a little tighter. It's not for my benefit, it's
right,
for yours.
So let's go back a year in time. So a year ago.
Well, let's not reminisce too far back, okay?
I just said a year. When we had this first meeting, it was an opportunity for everybody to be heard about what their issues were that they saw. And this wasn't all committees, this was strictly department heads. From that then helped the select board have a conversation about what our priorities were for the budget, and the outcome of that, if I recall, was that there was collective agreement that it was public safety first, specifically the police department. And there were concerns about the fire department, but we also wanted to make sure that everybody else didn't think that they were being ignored. It's just things have to happen. You can't take care of everything all at the same time. So some of that work has been done. Mike said he's fully staffed tonight. You came in. So I think we're moving off of the police department at this point. I think much of that has already been accomplished. We've certainly been having a lot of conversation with the fire chief about the fire department staffing. But that doesn't mean that the Council on Aging and the Municipal Building Committee don't also have concerns, you know. And so I think there needs to be an audience where we tell them where we're coming from. You know, are we indeed saying, you know, we feel like we really need to do something about the fire department this year? And based on the revenues that we discussed on January 4th, we're not sure how much of the pie is going to be available to go around. And it gives them an opportunity to argue other perspectives so that when we get down to looking at the budget, we're making a more informed decision. I mean, that's the way I'm looking at it.
It would seem to make sense not to change what David said because of the ballot vote on the 10th, mm-hmm. it'll give us a chance to air the results on the 18th mm-hmm. and how it's going to affect mm-hmm. the big picture.
And we'll keep the 25th open if we need it.
Yep, 25th is there's a put it on, and then if we don't have to have it, we can take it off.
Okay.
Is everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
So as presented, and then the 25th is a placeholder. Joyce, why don't you just put every Wednesday for the year, and then we'll just take them off now. And
I'm doing that. How'd you guess?
And the rest of them are fine.
Yeah, I think everything else.
This is my eraser here, just. Scratch.
Okay, so we don't need a vote on this. It's just administrative.
No.
Okay. Okay, so that is concluding our regular meeting. We do have an executive session scheduled for this evening, but does anybody have any announcements tonight?
It's not an announcement, but mm-hmm. we've missed the administrator's weekly report,
sure.
two or three reports, so mm-hmm. we've got a little time tonight.
That's entirely up to you.
I would love to have them give us update and everybody to hear. You can use this one if you need it.
All right, so thank you for the opportunity. We have been doing a lot of work with getting the departments ready for the budget season. We also have the auditors in this week. That's been going well. Lots of requests for information, which we've been able to handle. No stumpers yet. We had a public pre-construction conference on the public safety complex roof, and so everybody had an opportunity to hear the information, and it doesn't seem like there's going to be any real problems. All the logistics were talked about, all the security issues associated with keeping a public safety complex up and going at the same time as a new roof is going to go in. It's about a three-week project. It will start as soon as the weather permits. We had a pre-bid conference for the senior center design work, and a pre-bid conference for the fire substation design is coming up this Friday at 10 o'clock, so those projects are well underway at this point.
Can you go back to the Bay Road thing again?
Yeah.
So when are they going to start?
So I contacted the folks at the Mass DOT, and I said, come on, guys, where are we on the Bay Road Bridge? They apparently had to send some of the design back for review after the environmental permitting was done.
Do they understand we are in a crisis here? That we had a fire on Chamorro Road, and if it wasn't, that if the fire truck hadn't been out that day, it would have taken longer to get there?
Joyce, I've been impressing these people that that they had promised that this project would be done in December, and that doesn't seem
what,
like
what else can we do?
Who have we called?
What have we done?
You can complain to the legislative delegation. I strongly encourage you to do so.
Yeah.
I just think we all should, each one of us, send an email or something to Shyback and stuff. They fixed the bridge very quickly in South Deerfield. We have winter coming. We have plowing. We've already been through a snowstorm. I came through there 2 weeks ago when it was snowing. The lights were out. It was a red light blinking. And I called, and the dispatcher was very receptive and said I would call DLT immediately to get that fixed.
I would recommend calling John Seibeck. I'd recommend calling Stan Rosenberg. They're no strangers to the work that Mass DOT does.
Well, I think it's of utmost importance. Yeah.
I'm doing my part of keeping this pressure on.
I understand you are, but I want to know what we can do and to push this forward a little bit. This is just getting ridiculous at this point.
And I've already been in regular contact with John. He's well aware of it, but I think there's strength in numbers, and quite frankly, it gets down to the point where you just really need to annoy them.
I have spoken to him as well regarding it.
Yeah.
Could we draft a letter and have each of us sign it? Would that be encouraging or
honestly,
not worth
I
it?
Think a phone call goes
a better
longer way.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't want to take it out of anybody's hands, but let's do it.
No, just...
You could ask him to set up a meeting with him.
I like Donald's idea, but along with our representatives, one should go to governor, too, because he's dragging his feet with the bridges and the roads.
Yeah.
Releasing the funds?
Yeah.
Funds aren't the problem.
So I think this is more of a problem.
We just can't get them to do the work.
Right. It's really a DOT.
Well, they need to release if this bridge is in the plans to be replaced, which I heard some rumors about, then release the money and instead of fixing it, replace it.
Yeah.
I mean,
that money has not been approved.
Right.
Well, I know. But if the governor is aware of our situation here.
Safety is the utmost importance that we're thinking of at this point.
How about the Lieutenant Governor, Karen Polito?
Yep.
She's probably the best
all
audience.
All of them. If we're going to send a letter from the board to all the reps and the governor's office.
But I strongly recommend that you call them. It's nothing like your telephone call to help move things along.
Mm-hmm. So moved.
Okay. Thanks for asking, Joyce. All right, go ahead, David.
All right, so Turka Park is well underway. If you
and the residents can, too. I want to make them aware of that.
Yeah, they can call. So Turka Park's underway?
Well underway. So I had a chance to drive by there before the snow started flying, and it looks very much improved. We got good news from the Department of Energy Resources today. We've received a letter saying that their consultation with the town has been completed and is successful, and so we should be taking the next steps towards helping people save money on their electricity bills. We have public records compliance project is still underway, and we will be having that up and running by the deadline of January 1st. And I think I talked about the ballot questions and the informational strategy that we have for getting the information out to the Hadley voters. Just to remind people that there is a vote on January 10th from noon until 8 at Hopkins Academy. And that has to do with the 9 questions that were decided at the fall town meeting, and need a follow-up vote by the voters in order to approve the money. So look for your tax bills. Look for the yellow piece of paper in there that has the explanations. If you have any questions, feel free to give us a telephone call. Talk to your select board. Talk to your town administrator. We're happy to hear from you. Annual town meeting. Don't forget May 4th, 2007 is our annual town meeting.
17.
May 4th?
You said 2007.
17?
17.
Okay.
Is there an update on the ambulance committee? Have they met yet?
No.
Not met yet.
No. And, in large part due to Mike Spanknebel's workload and
family
situation. Mm-hmm. So we've been trying very hard to get that going. And I know at least one member's not going to be available come January for a couple of months. So you and I can keep talking about that.
Yep.
Dave, the MS4 stormwater permit information. I was with the Board of Health the other day, and they said that there may be some changes coming to that. Have you heard anything about that?
Are you talking about the national level?
Yeah.
We don't know. I mean, it's obviously a very new administration.
But there's been some conversation that may be relaxed.
We don't know. Yeah. We simply don't know.
That's what it sounds like on a federal level.
Yeah. I mean,
You don't know that there's been some conversations regarding that could be relaxed?
Yes, I know that there's been there's been a name that's put forth to head the EPA. That person has said that they would like to relax a lot of restrictions. Whether stormwater is high on their list of things to do, I don't know. Does that help us in time? Is the Senate going to approve this person? We just don't know. I think that we should be very careful about not funding our MS4 obligation with the hopes that somebody's going to let us off the hook. I think that is not what we should do.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any announcements tonight?
Well, I just have one for the public, is that the select board wishes everybody a Merry Christmas. And Happy New Year, because we'll see you after the New Year.
Mm-hmm.
And we wish you just much peace and happiness and good health for the coming year.
Hear, hear.
Okay. And our town employees also, not just our
everybody within our conference.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Okay. If that's it then, we do have an executive session scheduled this evening.
I'll make a motion to go into executive session, not to reconvene an open session for the purpose and provisions of MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21A2, to conduct strategy sessions in preparation for negotiations with union, non-union, or to conduct collective bargaining sessions or contract negotiations with non-personnel, i.e. will be the town administrator's contract tonight.
Okay. As chair of the Hadley Select Board, As chair of the Hadley Select Board, I've determined that the having these discussions in open session would have a detrimental impact on the town of Hadley.
And not to reconvene an open
meeting. Reconvene an open session.
Okay. Roll call vote. Moskowitz?
Yes.
Devine?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Chunglo?
Yes.
Kaczynski?
Yes.
Okay. Good night, everybody. Thank you.